Amistad and Harper Audio present Black Earth Wisdom, Soulful Conversations with Black Environmentalists, edited by Leah Penniman, read by Karen Chilton, Janina Edwards, Bill Andrew Quinn, and Landon Woodson. A note before we begin. Don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider or go directly to www.harpercollins.com/pages/Black Earth Wisdom. It contains notes from the print edition. Black Earth Wisdom is dedicated to Naima and Alan Penniman, my beloved Earthwise siblings. Opening.
Forward. By Dr. Ross Gay. I first visited Soulfire Farm, the farm Leah Penniman co-founded with her partner, Jonah Vettel-Wolf, in the summer of 2015. I was participating in one of their BIPOC farmer and training programs, which I found out about from an article in Yes Magazine sent to me by two different friends who knew I had been researching black farming, and was doing so because in my 10 years of serious gardening and classes and workshops and certifications and such, black folks seemed to be, well, few and far between. Scarce. Put it like that. Most of the gardening and farming and eco books I was reading were by white people. Wendell Berry, Rachel Carson, Aldo Leopold, Michael Pollan, etc. Masanobu Fukuoka's wonderful The One Straw Revolution was among the exceptions, as were most of the movies in that vein. The articles in magazines and such, the same. At some point, it became very clear to me that something was off, and so I started searching. And quickly, finding. The Black Farmers and Urban Gardeners Conference in New York. Will Allen, up in Milwaukee. Black Oaks Permaculture Farm in Pembroke, Illinois. Gillard Farms down in Brunswick, Georgia. I rooted around and found the email for Soulfire, then sent them a note expressing my interest. About a day later, I got a note back from Leah, followed by a phone call during which, after we got to know each other a little bit, I convinced her I was serious about this stuff. I was by then on the board of the Bloomington Community Orchard and had worked with some other growing projects. She invited me to join them for the next session. A couple of months later, I was with about 20 or 25 other farmers in training, in muck boots on the wet days, barefoot on the dry, harvesting raspberries and garlic, learning about companion planting and greenhouse growing and herbal medicine, and George Washington Carver and Fannie Lou Hamer, sharing food and stories and dreams, and dancing hard to Kendrick Lamar, Whitney Houston, and D'Angelo. Toward the end of the week, I remember leaning on my rake, taking a drink, sweating hard, looking down onto the fields as we were in the middle of a workday. The sky was clear, the sun was high, it was hot, and people were working hard, harvesting, weeding, transplanting, but no one seems to be toiling. There was lots of laughter, and some singing too, and no one seemed to be suffering. In fact, it seemed precisely the opposite. We seemed to be glad. We seemed to be joyful. We seemed maybe to be healing. As I looked down over those fields, it struck me like a bell. I've never seen a truer thing. In case you believed slavery and sharecropping and land theft and general misery was the entirety of black people's relationship with the earth, here was a different story. All us black people smiling with our hands and feet in the soil. Believe me, I wasn't the only one who said this as that we concluded, and maybe crying a little bit as we said, "It feels like I am finally home." And speaking for myself anyway, home didn't mean only that beautiful gathering with those beautiful people at this beautiful farm on this beautiful land in upstate New York, though it for sure meant that too. Home meant being in the ongoing stream of black and brown people through time, that enormous rhizomatic mycelial polyvocal coral community caring for and being cared for by the land. It meant returning together to the beloved earth. The transformative gathering at Soulfire, that togethering, is precisely the energy and spirit and power of Leah Penniman's beautiful book, Black Earth Wisdom, which brings together a diversity of voices, all of whom are guides to us, deep in the long practice of listening to the earth, one of the beautiful verbs Leah uses to imply closeness, attention, and devotion is listening. Those who practice are earth listeners. She talks with other farmers, marine biologists, lawyers, filmmakers, writers, musicians, ornithologists, teachers, activists, healers, and more, all wondering together how we might better listen to or care for or love the earth, which, it turns out, we sometimes have to be shown how to do, maybe especially if there's pain or sorrow to move through, which, for me, maybe for you too, there is, though pain and sorrow do not foreclose joy. In fact, and maybe this is some Black Earth wisdom, it's from the sorrow tended together that the joy grows. Another wisdom of this book is the way Leah has crafted the interviews into conversations, because conversations, if they are good, are also collaborations. They require that we listen to one another, and they understand that the answers are yet to be discovered. They offer us the opportunity to move toward one another. They offer us the opportunity to be moved. Leah, of course, is one of our guides, and an astonishing one at that. Her reverence for the earth, her storytelling, her intimacy with the land, well, it's almost like if you shook the pages of this book, seeds would drop out. She is among the earth listeners I rely on, one of the earth lovers who has changed my life. But it's crucial to note that this book, Leah's book, comes of her reaching toward other earth listeners. "What do you think?" she asks again and again. "What might we do?" she asks that of those who walk the earth now, and she asks it of earth listeners who walked the earth hundreds or thousands of years ago. What might we do? That's to say, she adamantly does not do it alone. In fact, you might say this book is a model for how not to do it alone, for how to do it together, which, if we're going to survive, we're going to have to practice doing. Oh, I could go on. But let me just tell this last little story from that time at Soulfire. After lunch and before getting back to work one day, someone rounded us all up to play a little game. I think they called it the mangrove game. It goes like this. Everyone gathers in a circle within arm's reach of their neighbors, twists into some swampy or boreal shape, something awkward and teetery that you'd never in a million years be able to hold on one foot. Then you grab hold of who's next to you, their forearm or shin or hand, and on the count of three, everyone picks up one foot, at which point, I was afraid, we would topple. I was the biggest person in that group and really didn't want to smoosh anyone. I don't quite know how to describe to you the pulse, the cinching or gripping up, the sudden rooting of 15 or 20 people becoming one sturdy organism, but I can tell you we shouted and laughed and looked. Some of us, baffled with delight, baffled by how easy it was, how strong we were, in a grove, all our roots grown together like that. We could have done it forever, it seemed to me, holding each other up, like the Black Earth's been saying all this time.
A Watotic Childhood. An Introduction by Leah Penniman. As children, my siblings and I spent long hours in the forested wetland, hopping from one sun-dappled mossy mound to the next, never slipping into the soggy muck and never stepping on any rare lady slipper flowers or vibrant red-spotted newts. When we grew tired of this game, we wrapped our arms around the nearest sticky white pine or fragrant yellow birch and breathed deeply. Having recently read about photosynthesis and respiration in the heavy encyclopedias our father kept, we imagined that the tree was gratefully taking in our carbon dioxide and gifting us with oxygen to inhale. We siblings passed hours this way, in the delightful safety and supportive embrace of Watotic lands. The swamp has long been a place of refuge for Black people in the Americas, a destination of escape, maroonage, or the promise of passage to a better land. As three Black Creole children growing up in a conservative rural white town in the 80s, we also relied on this refuge. To say that the Ashburnham public schools were racially brutal would be an understatement. From elementary school, when we were informed by a classmate that brownies are not allowed in this school, to the interminable bullying of middle and high school, which included taunting, assaults, and one student attempting to blind me with her fingernails so that I would be too ugly for white boys to look at, to the school officials' complicity with and excuses for the assaults, public school was a place of terror. Mount Watotic, Lake Watotic, and the forest in between became surrogate parents and protectors for us. These sacred lands of the Wabanaki, Pinacook, and Abenaki were rich in biodiversity, and each being offered an opportunity for relationship. We learned to make salads of wood sorrel, blueberries, and wintergreen, and to fish for rainbow trout. We became strong paddlers and navigated a dented aluminum canoe around the small islands in the lake. Our sense of home and wonder in the forest informed our invented religion called Mother Nature. We decorated an old abandoned woodshed with blue jay feathers and cedar, transforming it into our temple. Senegalese poet Baba Dioum wrote, "In the end, we will conserve only what we love." It must have been around third grade when we learned that nature was in trouble. A panicked alarm rose in our small hearts to hear for the first time about global warming, air pollution, and toxic waste. My sister Naima and I sprang into action and formed the Junior Ecologists Kids Club, which had exactly two members. When we could not convince our elementary school to start a recycling program, we put out our own bins and dragged home aluminum cans on the school bus to rinse in our backyard and redeem. We went on pollution patrol with our blue, huffy bicycles, picking up garbage, placing our bodies between loggers and trees, and gorilla planting the denuded medians in the road. We wrote original anthems and spoken word poems and sang these praise lyrics to the forest. Perhaps most ambitiously, we researched long lists of actions people could take to protect the environment, and Han wrote this advice on hundreds of postcards that we sent to people listed in the phone book. Naima and I made a solemn covenant with the wild animals and plants, pledging allegiance to the earth with these words: "We will never forget how to listen to you. We will always stand with you." This intimate and fierce love affair with earth remained intact as I matured. In the Black soils of Greater Boston, I found a passion for vegetable farming that eventually led me to study agriculture with indigenous peasant farmers in Haiti and West Africa. While studying traditional farming and eco-spirituality in Ghana with the Queen Mothers of Krobo Land, I was offered a teaching that has been seared into my soul ever since. Manye Nartiki, in blessed memory, asked, "Is it true that in the United States, a farmer will put the seed into the ground and not pour any libations, offer any prayers, sing or dance, and expect that seed to grow?" Met with my ashamed silence, she continued, "That is why you are all sick, because you see the earth as a thing and not a being." I majored in environmental science in university and launched a 17-year career as a high school science teacher, simultaneously lauded and infamous for my students' infrequent presence in the classroom. They were instead inventorying stream macroinvertebrates, conducting energy audits for local businesses, or testing community garden soils for lead. Concurrent with teaching, my family started Soul Fire Farm in 2010, an Afro-Indigenous-centered community farm dedicated to uprooting racism and seeding sovereignty in the food system through our emphasis on farmer training, feeding folks who lack access to life-giving food, and rabble-rousing for systems change. This learning journey revealed that the Mother Nature religion of our childhood was ancestrally remembered rather than invented, and I subsequently spent many years training as a member of clergy in the earth-based traditional religions of Yoruba and Vodun. As an introvert who is more at home speaking flowers than any of the oral human languages, the written word has become a place for safe and joyous expression. Farming while Black.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.